In Matthew 7, chapter 7, verse 24 this morning, we're talking about building a firm foundation. How many of you know you've got to have a firm foundation?
Amen.
I know you do. I built a home. I had an old home when we first got married. It's 100 years old, and it had a foundation under it, and that foundation had gotten a little rocky, and we had to and we had to do some work to repair it and put it back together. Then we built a new home, and we had to put a substantial foundation under it. And we're looking at our new home, a new place to build over here on Rocky Mount. We can't find a level piece of ground, and so we're going to have to figure out how we build around some big old rocks and put something in. But we know in our minds, Tony and I, that we've got to have a good foundation. A house does not stand on a poor foundation, and neither will we as Christians. We must build our foundation correctly. So if you'll turn with me to Matthew 7, stand for the reading of God's Word. We're going to read here. In verse 24, it says, "Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock." Father, I love you for your word this morning, and I ask God that you would somehow use this preacher. In my most simple way, will you help us to understand the words we find here in Matthew. And God, that you will bring to light the living word of the Bible in our hearts. Don't let it be just a bunch of words that might tickle our ears or entice us a little bit, but God, let it be you that speaks this morning. I pray. I need you, Lord, for I am lost without you. Guide and direct in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. You may be seated. Can I preach?
Amen.
Can I tell you a little bit of what this means to me? The foundation of a house tells you how big the house can be. It tells you how much that house can hold. I oftentimes see people who get saved and they immediately jump in and they are just all gung-ho. And I love that energy from them. I love that importance of that excitement. But what I always know is that unless they get in and build that foundation and get it firm, they will probably take on more than they can handle and they will get shaky underneath the weight. And it will not last. It will collapse every time, whether we're building on poor ground, or we're building with poor equipment, or we're building with poor materials. It will collapse. The same is true in our lives. And unless we get back to the Word of God and we really build our foundation on what God is telling us, we will collapse as well. How many of you have ever had a Christian friend that served God with all of their heart and they fell away? It's okay, raise your hands. I won't call on. I've had a lot of them over the years. If you look at the kids that I ran around with, I had 160 kids in our teen choir. My friend and I were soloists in the teen choir, so we were part of the nucleus that pulled the group together. We traveled across the country. We would sing in different locations, and it was wonderful. And I remember these young people that were a part of that, that had a real move and experience of God in their lives. And they... I was about to have a real moving experience myself. If I fall down, somebody just take over, okay? But they had a real move in their life, and they were close, and I looked up to them. They were pillars to me. They understood God's word to me. And I thought, wow, I wish I could be like them. But what I didn't know is they weren't about building a firm foundation under them.
And so many of those people now do not serve the Lord. They're not serving God. They weren't reading their word every day. They weren't looking in here for how we should go about building life. I am thankful that at an early age, my dad pointed to me in the book of Proverbs, and he said, here's some great instruction about building life and getting ready for all the things that will come before you. Here's some great examples. I'm glad that my father said to me, let's take a look at James, because you're going to encounter some things that you must be ready for and you must have a right attitude for. You must be able to focus and approach those things with a godly and a wholesome attitude. I'm glad because those became pillars of my foundation. Those were things that were important that keep me solid in the time of trouble and struggle. You can't become what God wants you to be on a faulty foundation. We've given a lot of different options for what the foundation of our lives is to look like. We can look at it from the lens of popular culture. Some people think they simply do what every other person is doing, and that's a good way to build. If everyone's doing it, it's okay. Have you been around those kinds of people? If it's popular, that's what we'll do too. Yet, what's popular today will not be popular tomorrow. What you're going to see is great and wonderful today is going to pass. You need something much more solid than that. Because if you're building your life on something that will change with the fads, then you will find yourself on shaky ground, sifting beneath you, and your foundation will not be solid. Basing your life on popular culture is like building a house on a constantly moving foundation. It will not work. It will not work. It's going to constantly move beneath you. Now, I know I try to look as hip as I can up here. If you take... LeBry's laughing at me. You don't think this is hip? No. I'm looking good, Bri. But you take this 53-year-old man who's slightly overweight and doesn't really, fit well in his clothes. You take this and you think, well, if all I did was follow the fashions and the fads, I would not be solid in my life. So I'm giving you an excuse for looking bad. No. We can't just follow the fad of everything that's coming along. We must look for solid nuggets and solid foundation to build ourselves upon. I always tell when I'm a shopper. Some of you guys may not know that, comes as a surprise. Most men do not like shopping. I happen to like it. I enjoy it. I shop for my wife. I shop for my family. I shop for my friends. I shop for myself, which happens to be one of my favorite things. But I like to shop. I enjoy shopping. I don't even know why I'm telling you guys that. I guess that's a sin I needed to confess, because I don't know why I'm telling you that. I like to shop. But I'll tell you what, when I'm shopping, what I find is that I always want to find a few good foundational items. So everyone should always have a black jacket in their wardrobe. Now, you can have the funny colors and be popular and go with the fad for a little bit, but you better have a black jacket in your closet, because you will need one. And it will fit every time. So if I had come in here this morning with my bright yellow jacket, I mean, it's a jacket, and it would have looked fine, but if I'd come in here this morning, you would have thought, well, first of all, it's not spring yet. Second of all, what are you, a sunflower? Thirdly, you would have, no telling what you would have thought. I'm not going to tell you thirdly what you would have thought. But if you come in with a black jacket, you kind of fit everything, right? So when I'm shopping, I always have to have foundational items,
things that you should have. That's important in building our spiritual life as well. We must have the Word of God. If you leave this place today without a Bible that you can call your own, it is no one's fault but your own, because we have Bibles that we will put in your hand. But you must have this Word of God in order to build on a firm foundation. All other things will shift beneath you. But Max Lucado's a good writer. Yes, he is. But it better line up with this. Do I read Max Lucado? He happens to be one of my favorite authors. I love reading his books. I think he brings things to life that are very, very real and makes me see them. And I like to be able to be visual and see them. But I do not read Max Lucado in place of this. Max Lucado is an add-on. It's a nice to have. It's not part of my firm foundation. My firm foundation is based here. I must know this. If I can say a nice little quick, you know, feel-good quote from a Max Lucado book, it does not make a good foundation. This is our foundation, and you must have it. So we talk about popular culture. Let's talk about tradition. Other people build their lives on tradition. It's the way it's always been. Hey, it's what my mom and dad did. You could say I'm kind of like that in a lot of ways. For years, I grew up saying, I will sing nothing but hymnals. That's it. Because the tradition that I love, and I love it, the tradition that I love is standing in a pew with that songbook open. My mother, my daddy sitting over here, my wife sitting here, and my children there. And to look and see they were all singing from the same book. That's important to me. I love that time. I love it. But here's what I found in my foundation. If I build my foundation on hymns, I will more than likely lose out with my children. You know why? Because my children weren't always listening to hymns. Now they know it because they were raised in church and we sang them. But you know what? I had to let them experience some different things that would keep them connected to God in a way that God could connect to them and their generation. It is the exact same way in our churches today. We can be fat and happy and pleased and excited, and we can sing from the hymns all we want, and you will have one happy preacher, but we won't see a lot of lost people come into the church. I told you last week I ran into a preacher who said, you know what, we've been looking for a new preacher, but we hate to bring one in because it might mix things up. He might bring a bunch of new people in here, and we don't want that. We're just happy the way we are. It is not a firm foundation of the church. You cannot build the church on tradition. The church is not the church of yesterday. It is the church of forever. This church is not going to be here in this same format, the way it sets today or it set 30 years ago. It is going to go along because we have to be able to reach the lost around our community. And we must do that in a way in which we can build firm foundations on them, on things that are scriptural and not things it's because I want it that way, or because grandma did it that way, or because daddy did it that way, or mama did it that way. It gets quiet in the church when you start talking like this. Because it means all of us have got to change. It means all of us have got to be accepting of others. All of us have to be willing and able
to open up our minds and say, God, you're God yesterday, today, and forever. And if I sing it this way or I sing it that way, as long as I'm singing it to you, it doesn't matter. As long as I'm lifting you up and glorifying you, that's what you want from me. That's a pillar in our foundation, is that we glorify God. Amen. In whatever we do, we glorify God. Amen. That is a pillar in our foundation. It will keep us strong. It will keep us from shaking. It will keep us from losing out. My wife, when we first came here, somebody came to the church. My wife met her, and we had sang a new course that morning, and my wife noticed the lady got up and walked out. So my wife followed her out and said, "What?" Something happened? What's wrong? And she said, "I can't take that music. I'm just used to singing slow hymns. And when you go to singing them fast, I can't take that." And my wife said, "Well, you know, we try to sing some slow and we sing some fast and we sing some choruses because we're trying to reach more than just you and what you want. There's more than just you in the church." She was new here, so it wasn't like she was rooted in anything. That's just what she had done, and she had, for a long time, we got to know her later, but for a long time, she had just moved from church to church, and every time they did something that she didn't like, they'd up and go. But that's not a foundation. There's no foundation there. And so my wife invited her, so my wife said, "Well, come back in and just see if we teach the Word of God. If what we do glorifies God." She came back in. She sat down. She came to me 3 weeks later and she said, "I think your wife saved my life." And I said, "How is that?" And she said, "You know, I walked out." I said, "Well, she did tell me that." We had a nice little lunch talk about that. And I said, "She did tell me that you did." And I said, "But I noticed you came back in." And she said, "It's the greatest thing because I have found a church that I can be happy in a church that serves God. I may not like all the music, but I will be able to serve God here." And she still goes here today. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I'm thrilled with it.
Amen.
You won't like everything I say as a preacher, but if you run me out every time I say something you don't like, you probably ain't going to grow much.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. I'll sit you your dollar right after service. In Mark 7:8, Jesus tells the Pharisees, "Never put tradition before truth." We are not to take the traditions. I'm telling you, I would worry about some of us if old Jesus was along with us for this walk. Because when I read the Bible, I find that Jesus did things that were not considered righteous. That Jesus did things that were not traditions. See, what we sometimes get confused about is those Sadducees and Pharisees, they were upset with him because he was doing it different. He was doing it different. Do you read in the Psalms what was going on there? Those were new songs being sung. Those were new things being done. Those were things that they were not used to in their tradition. And Jesus came along to break the tradition. And so when it says to me, a pillar of my foundation must be that I am not stuck in tradition, but that I am moving with the power of God. See, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. But what's amazing to me is that God is appealing to millennials in a new way. Do you know why? Because God knows millennials are different than us baby boomers. We liked it this way. God is now reaching millennials in a new way. Our churches are full of them because the churches that are recognizing that you have the ability to reach all ages and all people, then you are able to do that. And we're seeing growth in churches. Isn't that what it's about? So a pillar of our foundation must be, stay pliable with God, not stuck in our tradition. We must have reason within our foundation. God gave us the ability to reason. We need to use it. But our reason isn't infallible. Proverbs 16:25 says, there is a way that appears to be right to a man, but in the end, it leads to death and destruction. We think we're right. Could we be wrong? Could we be wrong in what we're doing? I know you work with me. Matthew and I put a new door in the house yesterday. Thank God Matthew's along. Because, you know, with me, it don't have to be just totally perfect. If that door goes in that hole and I can get in and out, I'm good. That's the way it works with me. Because when you have to start plumbing, and I don't mean those things you eat, but when you have to start plumbing and getting everything straight, and if you push this way, then it throws it out over there, and that gets to me after a while. So I have to have Matthew along to help, because I need his reasoning to help me get that thing in there right. Because I may be able to open and close it for a while, but unless I get it right, and everything's in alignment the way it should be, before long, I wouldn't be able to open and close that door. And so I need reason to help me in that. Now, it could seem right to me, but in the end, I'm going to be very unhappy with that door unless we've used reason. Unless we've been clear about how to do it. That's what the scripture is saying here in Proverbs. It seems right to us, and I'll tell you, there's many of Christian homes that says, well, it seems right, and we justify it, but I'm afraid in the end, destruction will come to us, because we have not built our house on good, sound reason. Good, sound reason. The smartest among us will falter at times. It's to be expected. Only God can be trusted all the time. We must have God involved in every decision we make. Lay it before Him. Ask Him. My grandma used to say to me, every time I started to do something big, I'd say, Grandma, I'm going to buy a car. She'd say, count the cost, son. Count the cost. The Bible says, count the cost. And I'd say, okay, we know it's going to cost us $10,000. And she'd say, no, what else will it cost you? It's not just the cost of that one thing. What else will it cost you? Will you be able to buy the diapers? Will you be able to buy the milk? Will you be able to do that? Will you be able to do that? You can look at it and say, oh, I can pay $10,000. Yeah, that's cheap. That's a good price for a new car. Would be nowadays, but back then, that was cheap. I mean, it was a lot of money, but I thought it was a great deal. And I wanted that little car. Grandma says, count the cost. When I went to build my new house, count the cost, son. Count the cost. Know the cost. What she was saying is, use reason. It may seem right for the moment, but is it right for the long haul? What will it cost you? You'll see tonight as we talk through our business meeting, it looks like, you know, God is doing great and mighty things. I'm counting the cost because it's a pillar of the foundation in which I want to build. It's a pillar of what I think the church has to have. And that is, you cannot spend every dime you get. You must prepare yourself for what might come along. You must be ready to stand ready, and you must be ready to protect this church at all cost. Amen. This body, this church, must go on with or without me. This church body must be protected and put in a place of success so that people will always be able to serve here. That is important. We'll talk about it more tonight. The other thing in our pillars of foundation that we need is emotions. Some build their lives on feelings. That feels right, they do it.
that doesn't feel right, then quit doing it.
The problem with our feelings,
they lie.
Our feelings lie to us. Our feelings tell us things that aren't really true. And so the moment that feeling changes, we no longer have the umph, the ability, the patience, or anything else to do it. It's why credit cards do not work. They will destroy your life because the feeling of getting new things feels good. Woo, I like it. The feeling, I said to, yesterday we came out of lunch and I said, let's just go buy something. That feels good. Let's just go buy something. It's been a long week. Let's just go buy something. Thankfully, nobody wanted to go with me, but so we went on home. But the emotion of that would lie to us. You buy it. It's credit cards. They lie to you. You buy it, and what you learn is that it feels good for just a moment. But the first time that bill comes in, you don't want to pay that bill. You've already felt the good feel. You've already felt the good emotion. That ain't fun anymore. So what do? You get another credit card and you go out and have fun. And then when the bill comes, you don't want to pay the bill. You want to feel good. So you get another one. Have you guys ever done this? I'm the only one. Figures. Figures the preacher would be the dumbest one in the house. When I got married, I married that woman on love. That's all I had. She looked at me and said, I got the best hunk of a man you could ever have. And that's all she got. We didn't have no money. And I'll tell you what happened to us is every time I turned around, a credit card came in the door. And you know what I told my lovely bride? I said, you know what? We can have hundreds of things and pay the same amount we pay for one. Let's just use these cards. And we used those cards. Oh my goodness, dear, did we not have a good time? My woman, she was young and beautiful, and she had hundreds of shoes and handbags. We had so much fun. We had new chairs in our house. My parents had never had a new sofa or new chair. We did. We had, remember the VCR came out? It was brand new when we were young and getting married. And we, a VCR, no, Sears sent me a credit card. And I got, not only did I get a VCR, it had a remote control. Now the cord on my remote control was 50 feet. It wasn't true remote. That's how old it was. But you know that thing cost me $700? A VCR, you can buy them for $99 now. I paid $700, was the talk of the town. My parents were in awe. They had never seen that you could video something and then see it. Woo! I had one of those great big camcorders, you know, the ones you carried like this on your shoulder. And I used to go to my niece and nephew, and I'd film every little program they were in. And then I had it on VCR, and we could watch it if we wanted to, but we never did, and still have it. But we have them. And so I spent all my money on that, and for the next 15 years, it wasn't so much fun. Credit and our emotions lie to us. If you can't pay for it, you don't need it. If you talk about a great feeling is when you can buy something that you write the check for or you pay cash for, and it's a great feeling to know when you wake up the next morning, you're going to appreciate it as much as you did the first day. It's nice when you've paid for something and it's yours. It's yours. I sometimes look at things and I think, wow, I never dreamed I'd have that, but that is mine. It's mine. That's mine. It means something. So our foundation item is that we cannot live on emotions. If you come in church one day and we're all hyped up and we're shouting and we're jumping, and the next time you come in and we're all praying and we're quiet and we're still, there's some people who base their church on that. All on emotion. The emotion will lie to you. You've got to stay faithful. You've got to stay strong. You cannot look at the emotions. Every judgment I make about myself, when before I make a decision, I say, am I emotionally reacting to this? That's why it takes me a while to get through things. I have to really gauge it and say, am I emotionally reacting to this? Because I want my foundation to be solid. If it doesn't work to build your life on popular culture or tradition or reason or emotion, what should you build upon? God's Word. You've got to have it in every aspect. You must have it in there. Jesus says in Matthew's again, 7:24, therefore everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who has built his house upon a rock. Popular culture changes. Traditions grow stale. They can be faulty. Emotions lie. Yet God's Word will never change. We must be ready to build a firm foundation. A firm foundation in your life looks as though you spend time daily praying and asking God to touch you. Every single day, you must thank Him for your life and what He has given to you. You must thank Him right in the midst of whatever it is that you don't think is right. You thank Him anyway, because He's still God.
Amen.
He's still God. When I got the call about Gordon, of course I was broken. Gordon was the most inspirational person I had ever met. The man had every reason in the world to complain and did not. Every single thing Tony and I needed done, he wanted to be a part of it, and he would help us do it. Every time I walked off this platform, and I will miss it today immensely. Every time I walked down from here and out that door, there was that coughing, husky voice. And he would take me with that shaking hand, and he'd say, Pastor, that was the best. I miss it. But I will tell you, in the midst of me missing, I was able to say, thank God. Thank God He had built His foundation on you, Jesus. And I know that today He is rejoicing with you. And so today I rejoice, because I know Gordon has shown me what life is. All the pretties and the frills and all of those things do not matter one bit. It is what you do for others. It is what you sacrifice for others. It is what you do for others. Do you know that Gordon lived most of his life helping his sister live? She became blind, but she loved the trails, and he would take her on every trailhead across this country, and he would tell her the story of what he saw. She lost her feet because of diabetes. Gordon pushed her in a wheelchair on trails until he could go no more. His sister needed a kidney. He donated his. And they took his and put it in her. He gave all that he had for someone else. The Bible says to me, what greater the love had any man that he laid down his life for his brothers, for his friends, for the people around him. I know he did that. I know he did that. And this morning, I would encourage you, as I believe Gordon would say to us today, build your foundation on Jesus Christ. Nothing else will work. Will you bow your heads with me this morning? Father, I love you and I thank you for your word this morning, God. And I've given it my best, Father.
I want, Lord Jesus, more than anything, to know that what you've given me, you will take care of and you will multiply. Father, I pray that you would encourage us this week. You would encourage us to go deeper in our word, to go deeper in our daily walk. Father, to look past the silliness of our traditions, the aspects of our emotions. Father, those things when we use no reason in what we're really doing. I would ask God that you would bring these words that we find in Matthew. We would bring them to our remembrance that when we base ourselves on you and what you have said, you are a solid rock and you are firm beneath us. And we will no longer shift around like sand. I thank you for that, Lord. Speak to our hearts now.